Today on Sports Desk, we'll preview the best-looking Stanley Cup final in years. It's the Blackhawks and Penguins. Scott Goodyear returns home to Toronto to a hero's welcome. And flashback with Willie Stargell, one of the all-time greats.
Sports Desk is brought to you by Motomaster, Canada's number one selling replacement parts.
Welcome to the show, everybody. I'm Michael Landsberg. Also ahead over the next half hour, McEnroe plays at the French Open. Was it the last time? CFL is thinking about returning to Montreal, and we talked to Buck Martinez about what is ailing the Jays. But we begin in Pittsburgh, where the best-looking Stanley Cup final in years begins tonight. On the surface, this final is everything you could want. You have two teams that are at the absolute peaks of their games, and two teams that have left absolutely no doubt they are the best in their respective conferences. You also have one of the best players this game has ever seen. The Penguins will begin defense of their title in less than an hour, and we go live to Pittsburgh, where our Gord Miller is standing by. Gord, I guess in terms of this series, there is no question who the key is.
Well, Michael, the focus of this series, which has yet to begin, was the player who wasn't even here this morning. Yes, it's a testament to Mario Lemieux's magnificence that even though he skipped the morning skate today, he was still the central topic of discussion for both the Blackhawks and the Penguins. Making room for Mario has been the subplot of this year's Stanley Cup playoffs for the Penguins, and they've done a great job, especially at the Civic Arena. Lemieux has played only four games in this arena, but has scored eight goals.
I don't do it. I mean, he's got a lot of ways himself of staying up high, affecting the forecheck, maybe going to another player, getting into position. And a key also is what the other players are doing for him.
I think that's kind of overblown. I mean, if any game and during the season or an exhibition game or even a playoff game, he's the best player in the world, and he's always got to be protected. So I think it's just magnified more because it's the finals, and you're playing the Blackhawks.
To listen to all the pregame publicity surrounding the Blackhawks, you'd think they'd be trying to play scoreless ties against Pittsburgh. That, of course, will not be the case. And Chicago is quick to remind fans that the Blackhawks have a pretty decent offense of their own.
Well, if the truth are known, the Blackhawks have generated more offense in the playoffs than the Penguins. And if you look at the offensive records, the Blackhawks have scored 4.5 goals per game. The Penguins have scored four. So we do respect their solo ability, their one-on-one ability. In particular, Jagr and Lemieux have demonstrated throughout the playoffs.
When you have a good defense, it's going to turn into a good offense. And we have guys that really make good of their opportunities early in games and sometimes late in games. Michel Goulet scored over 500 goals. He really knows when to put the puck in the net. And Steve Larmer, if he gets a good scoring chance, he's going to put it in pretty much 90% of the time.
But of course, whenever Mario Lemieux is on the ice, he will be the subject of very close scrutiny from all of the Blackhawks. Throughout the playoffs so far, Chicago coach Mike Keenan has stayed away from trying to match lines. But in game one of this series, look for Brent Sutter to play most of the game against Mario Lemieux. As well, Chris Chelios and Steve Smith will be on the blue line most of the time when Lemieux is out there. From the Pittsburgh side, not many changes, although Bob Airey is ready to return to the lineup. Scott Bowman will make his decision just before game time whether or not he'll play. He could make his first appearance in game two of this series. And one other note from these Stanley Cup playoffs, posting press clippings on the bulletin board won't be a problem. At least here in Pittsburgh, both newspapers are going through a strike right now. So the players are operating mostly in darkness, and both teams are pretty happy about that. The less they read about each other at this point, the happier they are. That's it from Pittsburgh for now. Let's go back to you, Michael.
Thanks, Corey. Gordon Miller will follow the series for Sports Desk right through to its conclusion, which might very well be seven games from now. You could make a great case for each team winning the series. The Penguins have the game's most explosive offense right now and have used it to beat the two best teams in the regular season to get to the final. While the Hawks, on the other hand, have played the explosive Red Wings and Oilers and have handled them both. So it's game one tonight in Pittsburgh. Two different styles of teams with great results in common. The Hawks have won 11 straight, the Penguins 7. Both have great records considering the competition especially. Interestingly, the Hawks are scoring almost as often as the Pittsburgh Penguins, while Chicago has a clear edge at the other end. Specialty teams, now keep in mind, Mike Keenan said that they were scoring 4.5 a game. Not quite that, but they're pretty close. In terms of specialty teams, the Penguins have the better power play right now, but Chicago's killing penalties better. And of course, the key will be stopping Mario Lemieux. Now, here's what Harry Sinden had to say about that. This is a quote. "So far, I haven't seen anyone who can neutralize him or bring him back to Earth. I haven't seen anyone figure him out. I think the best help you can get is from Mario himself if he doesn't show up." Which is certainly unlikely. That's Harry Sinden, general manager of the Boston Bruins, who found out recently just how good Mario Lemieux is. But the best matchup is behind the bench. In Mike Keenan and Scotty Bowman, you have two of the game's premier coaches. Also, two of the game's premier hardliners. Bowman and Keenan are both old school. They both dole out compliments about as often as they dole out smiles. They are perhaps the only two of that kind left. And they do have a history together. When Bowman was coach and general manager in Buffalo, Mike Keenan was coaching the Sabres AHL team in Rochester. Bowman wouldn't promote Keenan to the big team, so Keenan left. Perhaps the reason Bowman didn't move Keenan up was that he saw too much of himself in him. Too much ice, perhaps. Scotty Bowman will go down in history as one of hockey's greatest coaches. Just consider his record, 778 coaching victories, 5 Stanley Cup championships. He's been in the finals 9 times. He's won a Canada Cup. Mike Keenan also has an impressive coaching resume, but he is missing one critical reference, a Stanley Cup championship. He's won the Calder Cup in Rochester. He's been to the Memorial Cup with Peterborough. He's twice led NHL teams to first place finishes overall. He's won 2 Canada Cups. This will be Keenan's 3rd trip to the finals and probably his best chance at winning North America's oldest trophy.
Now the Penguins bench. Oh, Scotty's hot. Scotty. Mike Keenan. They have to restrain him. He is so mad.
Both men obviously have a deep, burning desire to win, and they go about it in similar fashions, especially when it comes to the players. Friends are nice, but apparently, according to these two, they don't win championships. Said Rick Tocchet of Mike Keenan, "He's a guy you wanted to kill one day and hug the next." Said Bob Gainey of Scotty Bowman's coaching style, "I remember we won. We won a lot." The finals are less than an hour away, and this series is important for both men. It could be their last chance to win Stanley Cups as coaches, but whoever wins, don't expect even a championship to melt through the ice.
Got a little frosty in here.
Coming up on Sports Desk, both teams take a pounding in Game 1 of the Stanley Cup Final. More applause for Scott Goodyear as he returns home. And hit the deck, it's Game 5 of the NBA Western Final.
Desk is brought to you by the Great Western Garment Company, bringing quality and comfort to Canadians since 1911.
Hello there and welcome to Sports Desk. I'm Paul Romanek. A packed show coming your way. Lots of other news in the hockey world other than just the final, although that is the feature attraction. Also, Game 5 of the NBA Western Final. That was a pretty good one. Went into overtime. But first up, Game 1. 1 year to the day that the Penguins returned to home with their first Stanley Cup, and this was a great game. Brilliant goals, a walk along the edge of a razor blade for Chicago penalty killers in the dying seconds, and it was only Game 1. It is only going to get better in all likelihood. Jim Belushi's in the crowd, pass the cup, he says. He's pulling for the Hawks and has reason to cheer early because Chris Chelios looks brilliant, beating Tom Barrasso through the legs, 1-0. And then the game gets tough. Ulf Samuelsson laying out Steve Larmer, Mike Peluso hammering Ron Francis. And off the great Chicago forechecking, Michel Goulet will pick up one and blast it home. 2-0 Blackhawks. Then 26 seconds later, more Chicago pressure. Belushi is loving it. Dirk Graham alone in front of the net. And it's 3-0 Chicago. What is going on, Pittsburgh? Second period, it's now 3-1, Steve Larmer to Brent Sutter. It is 4-1 for the Blackhawks. They are looking great, but the rest of the period belongs to Pittsburgh. Rick Tocchet, without his helmet, will deflect Paul Stanton's shot. It's 4-2, and then Mario Lemieux will bank the puck off of Ed Belfour. Look at him. He's almost at the goal line, and he ricochets it off of Belfour. The lead is now a single goal. And Pittsburgh fans dancing in anticipation. Jaromir Jagr, watch this. What a goal. Ties the score at four, and then with the game destined for overtime, Steve Smith pulls down Lemieux, and I talked about those Chicago penalty killers being on the edge of a razor blade. Well, they got cut. Mario Lemieux banging home a generous rebound from Ed Belfour, and Pittsburgh wins it. 5-4 is the final. Lemieux scoring the winner on the power play with 12.6 seconds remaining in the game. Just to review the scoring for you, Chris Chelios, Michel Goulet, Dirk Graham, and Brent Sutter for Chicago. Mario Lemieux with a pair, Phil Bourque, Rick Tocchet, and Jaromir Jagr for Pittsburgh. Gord Miller files this post-game report.
A year and a day after winning the franchise's first Stanley Cup, the Pittsburgh Penguins almost encountered disaster in Game 1 of the 1992 series against the Blackhawks. But thanks to their outrageous talent, the Penguins won an outstanding hockey game to lead this series 1-0.
Oh, that was probably the greatest goal I've ever seen. You know, I've scored a lot of big goals, but, you know, one down and picked up the puck and beat three, four guys. And he's got such great balance, can beat a guy one-on-one at will, and he's very strong with his upper body, and that was a great goal.
Well, after Jaromir was able to tie up that game, it's just like you're in overtime, and then the penalty we got, you know, it is overtime, actually, because we only had a few seconds left, and then I think after we got rid of the penalty and Mario got through the middle and the guy brought him down, you know, it's sort of, the pendulum really swung in our favor.
Well, it was a quick play. I don't know. I just saw the puck going at the net, and, you know, I was able to get it over Belfour. Actually, he was there for the save, but I was able to get it over somehow.
It's tough. It's a tough loss to take, but like I say, there's nothing we can do about that now. It's very important for us to make sure that we come back in Game 2 and play hard.
Tell us about the game, whatever you would have.
Well, it was a bad rebound, and he put it in the net. Not much more than that.
For the Blackhawks, it's not so much the loss, but the way they lost. Instead of taking a 1-0 lead in Pittsburgh's building, the Blackhawks must now console themselves with the fact that for much of the game, they did outplay the Penguins. But they didn't score over the final 28 minutes of Game 1, and as a result, suffered their first loss in more than a month of playoff competition. Gord Miller, TSN, Pittsburgh.
Little speculation now. This final series will, in all likelihood, be Scotty Bowman's final coaching appearance. He doesn't want to coach next season. He took the job this season under extenuating circumstances, Bob Johnson's death. The Penguins need a coach who can tailor and work with an immensely gifted offensive team. So who to succeed Bowman? Well, a man who would fit the bill perfectly is Ted Green. Word is he may be looking to move on from his position in Edmonton. Stay tuned. Well, when you consider the great job Pat...
Today on Sports Desk, the Penguins steal one from the Blackhawks. We'll learn more about the Penguins' latest superstar. The Expos and Astros battle it out at the Big O in Montreal. And another painful first round for Jimmy Connors at the French Open.
Desk, brought to you by Motomaster, Canada's number one selling replacement parts, and by Chevrolet. Times change, values don't.
Welcome to the show, everybody. I'm Michael Landsberg. Also ahead over the next half hour, the Expos tell us how they feel about Alou. We look at Nolan Ryan's career, and a couple of crazed Hawk fans show up in Pittsburgh. But we begin with a team that, by its design, should be able to hold a lead. The Chicago Blackhawks are perhaps the most disciplined team in the NHL. They win by sticking to their game plan, yet they can't seem to do it against the Pittsburgh Penguins, and it cost them last night. The Hawks look great in the first period, fair in the second, and poor in the third, blowing a 4-1 lead to fall behind the Penguins 1-0. Now, blowing a lead against Pittsburgh is nothing new for the Blackhawks.
The Blackhawks must wonder what they have to do to hold a lead against the explosive Penguins. Last night's come-from-behind victory by the Penguins marked the third straight game this year that Chicago has blown a lead against Pittsburgh. Brent Sutter's goal midway through the second gave Chicago a 4-1 lead, but Pittsburgh replied with four unanswered goals to win 5-4. On March the 15th in Chicago, the Hawks built a 3-1 lead, only to see it vanish in the third period as Pittsburgh won 4-3. And back on October 22nd in Pittsburgh, Chicago led 4-2 at one point, but the Penguins battled back to salvage a 4-4 tie.
Early in the first period, we were doing what we do best, getting the puck in deep and, on the body and creating some chances for us. And, we got that three-goal lead. We kind of got away from that and sat back maybe and tried to get a little too fancy.
We just have to make sure we play better. I mean, we didn't play very well last night. We got away from our game a lot, and when we were on our game, we dominated most of the play. Pittsburgh played very well. They took advantage of every opportunity they had, and then, they deserved to win the hockey game. They played a good game, and they came back storming. So we have to make sure that we get back on our game plan and work to our system more.
Most of the Hawks are playing in the Cup Final for the first time, and playing with the jitters may have added to the Penguins' comeback.
I think we're all a little bit nervous. A lot of us have never been there or been here before, so, I think the next game will be a little bit more relaxed and be able to concentrate on doing our jobs a little bit better.
While Mike Keenan calls blowing the lead inexcusable, perhaps it's more a reflection of Pittsburgh's amazing talent than Chicago's sloppy play. Mario Lemieux got the pair, including the game winner, but the talk of Pittsburgh was unquestionably Jaromir Jagr. He is looking more and more like the game's next superstar. Or perhaps that should be the game's latest superstar. But how much do any of us really know about Jagr? Gord Miller joins us from Pittsburgh. Gord, I guess only a real superstar could score the kind of goal that Jagr scored last night in Pittsburgh.
Michael, this city is still buzzing about Jaromir Jagr's goal last night, the game-tying marker that was the turning point in Game 1 of the series. And it was a goal that only served to enhance Jagr's reputation as a rock star-like figure in this city.
Wherever he goes in Pittsburgh, Jagr is mobbed by fans, mostly young female fans. He has become an idol in this city, and when a casual mention of a love for chocolate bars was mentioned, Jagr was caught in a chocolate avalanche.
I had over 1,000 Kit Kat home.
What?
I don't know. I think Mike Lang said something on a TV. I like Kit Kat, and people send me. I had over 1,000 home. I eat it all.
He's just a kid who has a lot of fun. I mean, he speaks broken English. He's getting better all the time. He learns English from watching the Bundys, the TV show The Bundys. He plays video games in bars. I mean, he's just a guy who's having fun. He loves America, and he likes girls. I mean, he's just like a normal American kid.
Even on the off day, when most of the superstars took the day off, Jagr was back on the ice, and on the ice longer than most of the other players. He's a young man who simply loves to play the game.
Yeah, we play for a couple of bucks, it's fun. If you play for money, it's fun. Play hockey. You can do whatever you want. It's fun play hockey.
Yes, he does love speed, on the ice and off, which has been a bit of a problem for the Penguins. You see, Jaromir Jagr has a bit of a driving problem. More than a dozen speeding tickets since last September.
I got 3 speeding tickets for 1 week. It's about somebody who...
Do the police know who you are now? Do they stop? Do they recognize you?
They know who I am, but they doesn't care.
Is Scotty or anybody talk to you about maybe slowing down a bit?
Not Scotty, but general manager Craig Petty.
What did he say?
He say slow down.
You probably wouldn't want to be a passenger in Jaromir Jagr's car, and you probably wouldn't want to be his insurance agent either, but chances are you wouldn't mind being his accountant, because very soon Jaromir Jagr is going to get a huge raise from someone in the NHL. He's already established his credentials as one of the best on the ice, and if he can just slow it down a bit off the ice, he's got a chance to be a star for a very long time. That's it from Pittsburgh for now. Let's go back to you, Michael.
Thanks, Gord. You watch Jagr, you get the feeling the game doesn't seem to be that high pressure after all. Tomorrow's a big day for the Hawks and the Penguins, but also for the Lightning and for the Senators. Tampa and Ottawa will go head-to-head in a coin toss. Winner gets the first draft choice on the June 20th draft. The first NHL awards have been passed out. Today on Sports Desk,
Mike Keenan has some harsh words for Mario Lemieux.
He's embarrassing other players on the ice as well as embarrassing himself.
The Canadian Sports Hall of Fame has five new members. And New Jersey Nets, a new head coach.
Is brought to you by Motomaster, Canada's number one selling replacement parts.
Hi everyone, I'm John Wells, and welcome to this edition of Sports Desk. Also ahead in the next 30 minutes, highlights from the French Open. Montreal gets ready to host the World Bowl, and Nigel Mansell sits on the pole again. Hockey leads off the early report tonight with Game 2 of the Stanley Cup Final just an hour away. The Blackhawks are feeling the heat after folding in Game 1 on Tuesday. After the loss, Hawks coach Mike Keenan lambasted his team for an inexcusable letdown. Today, he tried another tactic to get his Hawks ready for Game 2. Dord Miller is in Pittsburgh with the latest on a vintage Keenan performance earlier in the day. Gord?
John, it certainly was. Mike Keenan's coaching in his third Stanley Cup Final, and of course, he's coached a couple of Canada Cup teams as well, so he really knows his way around a news conference. Today, we're expecting him to talk about roster moves and possible strategy changes. What we got instead was a Keenan diatribe on NHL officiating and Pittsburgh star Mario Lemieux. The reason for Keenan's anger? Alleged dives taken by Lemieux in Game 1 of this series.
I can't respect Mario for diving. He's the best player in the game, and he's embarrassing other players on the ice as well as embarrassing himself, and I think embarrassing the game. Three times he took dives, two of them resulted in calls. And I just think he's a better player. He has the ability to address people in a one-on-one situation with his ability without taking dives. The thing that's upsetting is that the NHL management set a mandate before the playoffs began about diving and said that those people could, in fact, be given delay a game. And Mario has got the Mario rule, and that is he's a protected player. And therefore, they don't call the dives on them, which were obvious.
And Keenan adds that if something isn't done by the officials, the Hawks will retaliate in a most unusual way.
If that's the set of rules we're playing under, which wasn't supposed to be the set, then we'll start diving as well. I mean, it's a farce. It's disrespectful to the game, and it's not good for the game.
Well, you've got to love Mike Keenan, and joining me now is TSN hockey analyst and Toronto Star hockey columnist Bob McKenzie. Bob, what was that? Was that pregame posturing, or does Mike Keenan have a legitimate beef here?
Well, I think he's got a legitimate beef, but I think it's probably a 50-50. A lot of posturing involved here. My big surprise, Gord, was that he didn't do it yesterday. Yesterday would have been the perfect day to really mask the issues, and that's what coaches do at these types of news conferences. They want to come in and take away from the fact that Ed Belfour had a bad game, that Jeremy Roenick didn't play particularly well. Everybody would have been writing about Mario Lemieux and officiating in the National Hockey League, but here we are on game day and he does it. I think he probably has very earnest feelings about the way Lemieux dived in Game 1.
Now let's talk a little bit about other Keenan mind games. He really ripped into Jeremy Roenick and Ed Belfour after their performances in Game 1. How do you think those two players will react?
Well, he's done that all year. In fact, since those guys have become Chicago Blackhawks, he's never hesitated to be very hard on them. That's the way he feels. They're very young. They're very resilient. They'll come back and bounce back with that kind of motivation. Those two players say, hey, we don't need that kind of motivation to get ourselves going, but if Mike wants to give it to us, that's fine. You will note, however, Mike Keenan very rarely, Steve Larmer and Brent Sutter, ever give them the kind of criticism. It's always veiled criticism when there is any at all.
What about the actual hockey game tonight? What do the Chicago Blackhawks have to do to contain Lemieux and Jágr particularly?
Well, they did a great job containing Lemieux and Jágr last game up until late in the third period. Really, you know, as long as Chris Chelios and Steve Smith are on the ice, Chicago's in great shape. There were two times they went off for very brief refs, 14 seconds each time Pittsburgh capitalized and scored a goal in that last game. Mike Keenan talking tonight maybe about splitting the two up so he's got either Steve Smith or Chris Chelios on the ice at all times, but I still think you'll see an awful lot of them together in tonight's game.
All right, Bob, thanks very much.
Thank you.
Now, when you talk about this hockey game, you talk about a couple of teams that really feel they deserve to lose Game 1. In the military, they say the generals are always fighting the last war. Well, in these hockey series, it's safe to say that Pittsburgh and Chicago are still playing Game 1.
The Hawks were at their most effective when they forechecked and hit the Penguins hard in Game 1. It directly resulted in this goal and kept the Penguins off their game in the early stages of the first encounter. The Hawks are promising a return to that style for game two. And the Penguins say, bring it.
If they want to skate, we can skate. If they want to play physical, we'll play physical. And you know, all the way through the playoffs, we've been in some pretty physical series with the Rangers in Washington. And you know, it's not going to be any surprise to us if they're running around out there trying to take us off our game. We've been pretty disciplined all the way through the playoffs, and hopefully tonight will be no different.
We want it to be physical. I don't think there's anything wrong with physical. We just want it to be clean. I think if the referee has his job to do, and obviously we don't mind hard-hitting hockey at all.
The danger, of course, is that more physical play will result in more penalties for the Blackhawks, something Chicago does not need with Pittsburgh's high-powered offense.
There's a fine line there, but the thing with it is that, you know, you got to play with composure. And, I mean, this, when we're, you know, you hear so much talk about physical aggressive hockey, and, you know, it's true, but doing it within the system. It
sounds like Keenan's putting a lot of pressure on their players over there to step up and do the job, but, you know, we know they'll be ready, so we got to be ready to answer the bell here tonight.
No roster changes for the Penguins after game one of this series. However, Chicago does have a couple of moves to make. Rob Brown will not play tonight. He has a pulled groin. And look for Rod Buskus to get into the lineup for the Blackhawks on the blue line. Maybe Brian Marchment will be the player taken out, but Mike Keenan not happy with the play of his blue liners aside from Smith and Chelios. That's it from Pittsburgh for now. John, let's go back to you at Sports Desk.
All right, Gordon, a couple of final notes. In 53 previous best-of-seven cup finals, the Game 1 winner has gone on to take the trophy 43 times, one of the teams to beat the odds, the Penguins in last year's Stanley Cup Finals. Meanwhile, rumors that Guy Chiron was headed back to hockey...
Coming up on Sports Desk, Mike Keenan's worst nightmare. Mario Lemieux comes up big again for Pittsburgh. Day four of the French Open, Yvonne Lendl pushed to the limit. And the Utah Jazz hope the return of John Stockton will inspire them against the Blazers.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Sports Desk. I'm Chris Seaton. He's also coming up in the next half hour. Chuck Daly has found another coaching job in the NBA. The Lightning and Senators flip a coin over first pick in the draft. And news about the Molson Indy and the upcoming World Bowl in Montreal. But first, game two of the NHL Stanley Cup Final. And the Chicago Blackhawks, of course, rewriting the record books with 11 straight playoff wins. But that streak came to a grinding halt Tuesday in game one. Thursday night, game two at the Civic Arena in Pittsburgh. The Penguins hoping to extend their playoff win streak to 9 straight games. Mike Keenan expecting a better effort from some of his big guns in game two. Mario Lemieux with some early game theatrics. Hawks go on the power play. Bob Airey gets the breakaway, beats Ed Belfour on the backhand. Shorthanded goal, 1-0 Penguins. Jeremy Roenick has been quiet in the series, but Jaromir Jagr, here's him after this hit. Late in the first, Dirk Rayan gets a shorthanded breakaway, but Tom Barrasso stones him. Second period, Lemieux takes a breakaway pass, and Belfour surprises him with the poke check. Hawks get a minor lift from the save. Brian Noonan does some good work, feeds Brian Marchment. He shovels it in, game tied at 1. Pittsburgh responds on a power play. Rick Tocchet finds Lemieux in the slot. Big Mario pulls the trigger. Pretty passing play, 2-1 Pittsburgh. Still in the second period. Tocchet goes to work again. This time looks for number 66. Lemieux bags his second of the game. 3-1 Pittsburgh. Meanwhile, Roenick clocks some time on the Hawks bench. From then on, the Penguins kept all Hawks sharpshooters in check. Mike Keenan can't get anything to jump for the Blackhawks. The Stanley Cup clock keeps ticking away for the Penguins. 3-1 the final score. Pittsburgh now leads the series 2-0. Marchment, Lemieux with 2 for Pittsburgh, and Bob Airey with the other. Pittsburgh has won 9 straight in the postseason. Lemieux, 5 game winners in the playoffs. And Jeremy Roenick was held out without a point for the second straight game and has just 1 shot on goal so far in the series. Now let's have more from Pittsburgh and join our Gordon Miller.
After an offensive showdown in game 1 of this series, game 2 turned out to be more of a tight-checking defensive affair. Fine for the Pittsburgh Penguins, who leave this arena up 2-0 after an impressive 3-1 victory over the Blackhawks.
There are many things that we want to do tactically to improve our offensive chances, and we've discussed them, and we have to continue to try to educate our players regarding some of the things we'd like to do. They're not executing very well at this time.
tonight's game. We had the lead, and we were determined that we were going to, you know, they'd have to really fight through us to score a goal. I think once we killed the penalty, it gave us a big lift.
Well, we felt it was certainly important for us to win the first two, especially Chicago, the way they've been playing in their building in the playoffs. They're very tough to beat in there. And we certainly didn't want to go in their building 1-1, so the first two were crucial for us.
Once again, an interesting subplot to this series was Mike Keenan's bench jockeying in Game 2. Steve Larmer and Jeremy Roenick saw very little ice time in the hockey game. It drew surprised looks from the Penguins. And for Roenick, it just built up the frustration for a superstar who's been unable to get on track.
Well, it's frustrating. I mean, because you think you're going, you think you're working, you're making some good hits, some good plays, and all of a sudden they get a couple goals, and you're sitting on the bench.
I think everybody was surprised not to see Roenick play much tonight in Larmer, but... you know, I guess it's up to Mike Keenan to decide who he puts on the ice.
Shortly after Game 2 was over, they began setting up for a circus here at the Pittsburgh Civic Arena. But the series moves on to the zoo known as the Chicago Stadium, where Mike Keenan will try to press the right buttons to get his Chicago Blackhawks back in the series. If he can't, the Penguins may not need this ice surface again. Gord Miller, TSN, Pittsburgh.
Game 3 of the Stanley Cup Final continues at the noisy Chicago Stadium Saturday, May 30th. The Hawks trying to get back in it. They're down 2-0 against the defending Stanley Cup champion, Pittsburgh Penguins. The coin toss was held at 6:30 p.m. Eastern Time in Pittsburgh just prior to the hockey game to decide which expansion team would get first pick in the NHL expansion draft and first pick in the entry draft. The Ottawa Senators won the expansion draft coin toss, while the Tampa Bay Lightning won the toss for the first pick in the entry draft, which will be held June 20th in Montreal. And one...
Today, for Chicago, it will hopefully be their first step back against Pittsburgh. See Mike run, see Mike jump, see Mike throw. And the red play, not okay, for Edberg and Chang in Paris.
Sports Desk, brought to you by Wiser Locks. Quality locks made for Canadians by Canadians.
Hello again, everybody. Welcome to this edition of Sports Desk. Also during the next 30 minutes for you, Game 2, Blue Jays weekend series with Chicago. Wanted, NHL coaches. There are several jobs open. And so what's new? Mansell is on the pole again. But first, how much is home ice worth? It's an awful lot when it is the madhouse on Madison. The Chicago Blackhawks are back home, trailing Pittsburgh 2-0 in their Stanley Cup final. But no, they've only lost once in 7 playoff games at the stadium this season. And with more from Chicago, where it is quiet now, but won't be for long, here's TSN's Gord Miller. Vic, you're right. Whenever the playoffs come to Chicago, the stadium becomes a part of the story. The Blackhawks certainly hope that's the case in this Stanley Cup final, that this building will help get them back in the series. As soon as you walk in, you know you are in a rink unlike any other. You are in the Chicago Stadium, the arena that gives the Hawks their huge home ice advantage.
I don't think there's any question about it. Our club feeds off the energy in this building, and our fans have been tremendously supportive. We've played, as I mentioned yesterday, extremely well in the stadium, not only in the playoffs, but during the course of the year, and we expect to do the same again tonight.
Certainly the Hawks need to change their strategy to try to slow down Mario Lemieux and company, but the friendly confines of the Chicago Stadium won't hurt either.
Well, it's a smaller building. We pride ourselves in playing that in-your-face style hockey, and that's the kind of hockey we have to play here. Things happen a little faster here. We can get on top of them a little quicker, and hopefully tonight it's going to be to our benefit.
Well, we're allowed to play a little more aggressively because of the size of the rink. I think that's the main difference, and hopefully they won't be able to freewheel and get that speed in neutral zone.
For their part, the Penguins are used to playing in buildings like this. Just last week, they completed a sweep of the Bruins at the Boston Garden. And Kevin Stephens, who had a 4-goal game in Boston, says don't look for any changes in the Pittsburgh game plan.
the crowd's going to be a factor, but, you know, we like that, and, you know, it's not going to do anything to our game. We're going to go out and play. We played well on the road. We're an experienced team, and we know what we're to expect, and we'll be there when we have to be there.
There's not as much room out there, so things are a lot tighter. You got to make decisions a lot quicker, and if you don't adjust, you're going to get destroyed. We were able to do it in Boston. Now we got to try to do it here in Chicago.
And once again, the games being played off the ice are almost as interesting as the ones taking place on it. Mike Keenan said today that Jeremy Roenick's thumb is bad, but that he'll play tonight. Keenan was asked what he'd say to those people who would say that perhaps Roenick isn't that seriously hurt. Keenan got very angry and said that question struck at the heart of the Hawks' integrity. Scotty Bowman was asked if he thought Roenick might be bluffing a bit, and he too got angry, saying he will not turn this series into some kind of a circus. One thing's for sure, this building will be a circus tonight as the Blackhawk fans try to get their team back in the series in which they trail right now 2-0. That's it from Chicago for now. Vic, let's go back to you.
Gord, thank you. Some other Stanley Cup things. Teams leading the final 2-0 have won 32 of 35 Stanley Cup championships. Jeremy Roenick, you mentioned him, Gord. Well, he has just one shot in the two games played so far. Mario Lemieux, with 14 goals, is just four behind the playoff record of Reggie Leach and Jari Kurri. And Pittsburgh has won seven straight playoff series, the record 19. The Islanders did it from the years 80 through 84.
Coming up on Sports Desk, the Stanley Cup Finals shift to Chicago and things heat up. Michael Smith continues to gain momentum as he gets set for Barcelona. And the seeds get buried at the French Open.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Sports Desk. I'm Gino Retta. Nice to have you here. Today's top story now, Blackhawks Penguins, Game 3 Stanley Cup Final, and the very noisy Chicago Stadium. Pittsburgh leading the series 2-0. 35 Stanley Cup Finals have been decided in the best-of-seven format. In 35 years, only two teams have come back from 2-0 deficits. A lot of talk about Pittsburgh's high-powered offense, but let's talk defense. Game 2, the Pens only gave up four shots in the second and just four more than in the third. And Jeremy Roenick, the Hawks' leading scorer, just one shot on net in the first two games. But the Hawks were back at home now. Would this make any difference? Jeremy Roenick, back without a cast. Jeremy Roenick, not treated with kid gloves at all. Gordy Roberts sends him flying. Midway through the first period, Hawks come close. Steve Larmer lets it go down the wing, off the iron. Mike Keenan shakes his head, says, what have I got to do to get a goal? Very physical. Ulf Samuelsson, big hit on Jeremy Roenick again. Later in the first, Penguins open the scoring. Jim Pack shot. Tipped in by Kevin Stevens, 1-0 Pittsburgh. Chicago kept close tabs on Kevin Stevens as Brent Sutter rides him into the boards. To the second period now, Jeremy Roenick with a great rush up ice, but Tom Barrasso kicks out the leg and keeps the puck out of the net. Early in the second, good scoring chance now for Jaromir Jagr. Puts on a great display, goes to the backhand, but Belfour makes a stop and stops Troy Loney on the rebound. Late in the second period, Mario Lemieux sends in Rick Tocchet on the breakaway. Rick Tocchet cannot beat Belfour. Still 1-0. To the third period now, Chicago trying to tie it up. Brian Noonan moves in, but Barrasso makes the big stop. Still 1-0. Hawks trainer Lou Varga feeling the pressure as well. 1-0 Penguins. Less than 30 seconds to go in regulation. Larry Murphy baits Chris Chelios by roughing up a little bit. Chris Chelios keeps his cool. No, he spears Murphy. Not a bright move. Loses control. And as Mike Keenan watches, Chris Chelios just goes after Murphy as Murphy turtles. Chelios gone. Ed Belfour watches as time ticks off the clock and Pittsburgh wins the game by a score of 1-0. Kevin Stevens, the only goal scorer. Chicago now trails the best of seven series 3-0. They are in big trouble. Gord Miller with this post-game report.
It wasn't exactly pretty, but the Pittsburgh Penguins will take it. They'll take a fluky goal. They'll take a 3-0 series lead. And when the series resumes on Monday, the Pittsburgh Penguins will have a chance to take their second straight Stanley Cup.
Yeah, we're certainly not used to that, winning 1-0. But everybody talks about our offense. But I think what won us the Cup last year was our defense. And again, this year in the playoffs, if we got to the final, it was because of our defense also. And that's how you win Stanley Cup.
A lot of times, you know, when you have Lemieux and Jagr and guys like that, you know, they over... Sometimes, you know, they get all the press and the defense doesn't get anything. And I, you got to really give a lot of credit to the guys on defense tonight. They won the game tonight, defense and goalie.
You could see it as they came off the ice, and you could hear it in their voices. The Chicago Blackhawks aren't yet out of this series, but they're close.
You could say we're a little bit snake-bitten, or we never got a bounce tonight. It's hard to explain how a game could unfold as this one did. They scored a fluke goal. The point man took a shot and hit somebody in the sideboards and went into the net. And we just didn't generate any offense.
You know, you can blame a lot of things like JR's hand and this and that, but, you know, Tarasso made some big saves and made some big stops when they needed. And, you know, you're not going to win any games not scoring any goals, that's for sure.
Perhaps most indicative of the Hawks' troubles in this series, Chris Chelios losing his cool late in the third period of Game 3. Chelios and most of the Blackhawks stars bolted from the Chicago dressing room without speaking to the media. And really, what's left to say? 50 years ago, the Toronto Maple Leafs came back from a 3-0 deficit to win the Stanley Cup. But a similar comeback seems unlikely here. The Blackhawks have scored just 2 goals in the last 8 periods. It's been all Pittsburgh. And soon it appears it will be a second straight Penguin Stanley Cup. Reporting from the 1992 Stanley Cup Final, Gord Miller, TSN, Chicago.
Incidentally, just before the game, Lemieux finally spoke out about Adam Graves. He said that the slash that broke his hand was intentional, no question about it. Lemieux said he's never been hit that hard in his entire life. And John Ziegler may be ousted as early as Monday. The NHL...
Coming up on Sports Desk, an injury brings Michael Smith down to earth in a Barcelona tune-up. More late-inning heroics for the Jays in a weekend series sweep. And it's a race to the finish between Senna and Mansell at Monaco.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Sports Desk. I'm Gino Retta. Nice to have you here. Also ahead, the Penguins 1 win away from the second consecutive Stanley Cup. Patricia He hits a roadblock at the French Open. And the IAAF, a complete story for you from Nancy Zinos a little later in the show. But first, the Gutsis wraps up in Austria. 8 weeks to Barcelona. Michael Smith in Gutsis for the final decathlon. Tune up to the games. Dan O'Brien, the world champion. Dave Johnson, a fellow American, are both conspicuously absent. But that hasn't slowed Smith down. He had personal bests in the 100 and 400 meters and led going to the final day of competition today. Unfortunately, he also brought with him a sore hamstring, so it was a rough day too. He finished third in 110-meter hurdles, dropped to second. Next, the discus, a very subpar performance for Smith. His best throw, 44.40 meters, keeping him in second. Pole vault next, and Smith does even worse. He just barely clears the opening height on his last attempt just to stay alive in the competition, but that was it. Improved slightly in the javelin, his best throw there, 63.62 meters, and because of that, Smith would drop to third. Last event of the day, the 1500 meters, and he needed to beat the leader, Robert Zmelik, by 17 seconds to win this event. But it was not meant to be. Zmelik finishes second in the race, Smith finishes way back. He had to settle for third place in the overall standings, which overall shouldn't be very disappointing, but the fact that Dan O'Brien and Dave Johnson were not at the event, it is very disappointing for Michael Smith, finishing third. Zmelik first, Eduardo Hamalainen of the CIS finishing second. Incidentally, the good news for Smith is that his hamstring injury is not expected to hamper his preparation for Barcelona. Blackhawks in big trouble thanks to a 1-0 win last night. The Penguins are now just one win away from a series sweep. A pair of Samuelsons, Murphy, Pack, and Roberts as your core of defense. Tom Barrasso in net. Not exactly the defensive personnel that you would pick to lead you to the Stanley Cup final, but they have definitely been getting the job done. Chicago with just one goal in the last two games.
The Penguins are prepared for a strong start by the Blackhawks. Chicago came on strong but didn't get anything out of it. Steve Larmer had the best chance, but he hit the post.
We talked about how they'd have a quick start, and that was the game, I think, when we didn't fall behind in the first period, and that was actually the difference in the game.
It's appropriate that the only goal of the game would be one of the ugliest of the playoffs. After much debate, Kevin Stevens was given credit, and the Penguins had a 1-0 lead, the only goal in a defensive game.
Great stingy defense by both clubs, and the winner goes home with a win because of a fluke goal.
After that, it was all up to the defense and the goaltending. And once again, Tom Barrasso had a very solid game.
Even with 30 seconds left, you know, you still have to realize the game's not over. We still had some time to get off the clock, and really that's the bottom line. It's not over until the final horn goes.
The Pittsburgh defense was so aggravating, Chris Chelios attacked Larry Murphy with less than a minute to go in the game, and Chicago still fighting for the tie. In the end, an ugly goal. Tom Barrasso and the Penguins defense won game three.
You know, when you have Lemieux and Jagr and guys like that, you know, they get all the press and the defense doesn't get anything. And you got to really give a lot of credit to the guys on defense tonight. They won the game tonight, defense and goalies.
I think what won us the cup last year was our defense. And again, this year in the playoffs, if we got to the final, it was because of our defense also. And that's how you win Stanley Cups.
Gord Miller now joins us from Chicago. I guess experience is a key factor now. Majority of the Penguin team earned their first Stanley Cup ring last season.
You know, you're right. This experience is old hat for most of the Penguin players who went through this experience last year with Pittsburgh. But for one, winning the Stanley Cup is a dream that has yet to be fulfilled. And Rick Tocchet has certainly played a major role for the Penguins. He's been arguably their best player in this final series. Of course, he's been here before, the last time with the Flyers in 1987, a seven-game heartbreaker. And there were times when Rick Tocchet gave up hope.
Well, after 87, I said to myself, and I remember talking to Scotty Mellenby in the summer, saying, well, we'll get there again. And lo and behold, 4 years later, you just figure, I'll never get here. I mean, it just seems like you don't see that light at the end of the tunnel. It just goes to show you that you don't take winning for granted.
The trade that brought Tocchet to Pittsburgh from Philadelphia was a surprising one at the time, surprising to fans and to Rick Tocchet.
I bled orange and black for so many years. I loved them, and it loved playing for Flyers. But this year, it just seemed, when I got back in the Canada Cup, it just seemed different. It didn't seem like the Flyers. It didn't seem like I wasn't myself. And it was just better for me to leave. You know, it's not an excuse. It's just sometimes you have to leave certain situations, and I needed to leave that situation.
He has a lot more character than I thought he has, and I'm really appreciative of that. We knew he was a great character player, but we didn't realize how great a character he was. And, you know, his presence on our team and on our bench and in the dressing room has been a big plus for us.
And right away, Tocchet was a physical presence for the Penguins, but during the playoffs, he's kept his cool. There's been a lot less of Rick Tocchet in the penalty box and a lot more of Rick Tocchet on the score sheet.
Against a range, I don't know how many punches in the head that I took. It's tough to swallow, but then, you know, it's funny because you go by, you know, fans of mine, or, you know, they want to see me grab somebody and kill them and stuff, but, you know, they don't understand that, you know, I'll take a cut in the face just to win.
Now, whenever the Stanley Cup is presented, it will be done by NHL President John Ziegler. On Sunday, his spokesman Bill Wilkerson held a briefing and announced that a committee of five governors, Ed Snyder, Marcelo Boo, Bruce McNall, Dick Patrick, and Mike Ilitch, had been formed and will discuss with Ziegler all aspects of succession. Now, that committee will then report to the NHL Board of Governors during the draft, June 21st and 22nd in Montreal. It's worth noting there are three camps of owners, those who would like to see Ziegler go right away, those who would like to see him stay on for about a year or so, and those who would like to see him fulfill his full term, which is June of 1996. But it appears John Ziegler's fate will be decided at the NHL Board of Governors meeting in June. That's it for now from Chicago. Gino, let's go back to you at Sports Desk.
Thank you.
Today, what's happened at the Stanley Cup? The not-so-great series, Chicago and Pittsburgh. The latest great Canadian quarterback hope in the CFL. And from playing baselines to minding baby, it's a great change for Chris Everett.
Sports Desk, brought to you by Motomaster, Canada's number one selling replacement parts, and by Western Union, the fastest way to send money.
Hello again, everybody, and welcome to the start of another week here on Sports Desk. Also coming up during the next 30 minutes for you, we have quarterfinals. They are now set at the French Open in Paris, as well as the ever-popular Plays of the Week. But first, it's only been done
once before. These Toronto Maple Leafs came back to win four straight games after losing the first three games to beat the Detroit Red Wings. That was the 1942 Stanley Cup Final. Now, 50 years later, Chicago, these Blackhawks face the same situation, down three games to the Pittsburgh Penguins. Suddenly, this great series has turned into a dud. I think most people expected Chicago and Pittsburgh to go at least six games, if not seven. But instead, we're now looking at a possible Penguin sweep. Gord Miller joins us from Chicago, and I'm sure, Gord, a lot of people are surprised there as well, aren't they?
Vic, it depends entirely upon who you talk to. The Pittsburgh Penguins say this series has not been close because they're a better defensive team than most people thought, and they've played their defensive style perfectly. The Chicago Blackhawks think they've been unlucky, that they probably should have won either game one or three to make this a much closer series. The fact of the matter is those games may have been close, but the series is not. And as the NHL goes to June for the first time with the Stanley Cup playoffs, the Penguins are looking to close it out tonight.
It is frustrating. I mean, we haven't gotten any breaks this series so far. I mean, you see the goal that they won on the other day. It was kind of one of those things where it wasn't even a shot on net, really. And it's frustrating to see that happen when you hit a hot goaltender like Tommy Barrasso, who's playing exceptionally well. It's tough to get to him, and it starts to get frustrating.
Sure, things have happened in the past, but we can't dwell on the past. We have to look to the present right now, and that's today, and that's the game tonight, and we come out of the shoot, and maybe we get up a couple of goals on them, we can win a hockey game and give ourselves a chance to play another game.
But while the Chicago players are concerned about a quick start, Coach Mike Keenan refuses to put all his eggs in the first goal basket.
It would be nice to gather some momentum, certainly, and I think that you're alluding to the fact that that Steve Larmer rang one off the post, and if it had gone in, it probably would have helped garner some momentum here in the stadium for us. But you can't determine how that's going to unfold, and you certainly can't build a game plan based on who scores the first goal of a game.
And while the Hawks are playing just to extend this series, the Pittsburgh Penguins, giddy in their pregame practice, would like nothing more than to put a bow on this thing tonight.
Obviously, it's not do or die for us, but in a sense it is, because, you know, you can't let any game slip away, and we don't want to let this game slip away because, you know, anything can happen. Fluke goals, power plays, injuries. So the longer things go, the more advantage that something like that could happen.
We don't want to let them back into the series, and today would be a great day to finish it off. You know, they're a great team over there, and they'll never give up. So, you know, we have to, I guess, kick them while they're down.
Every Penguin player knows that getting your name inscribed on the Stanley Cup is a rare experience. It has not been uncommon, however, for Brian Trottier, who today will try to become only the 12th player in NHL history to have his name put on the cup for a sixth time.
I came to Pittsburgh because I felt there's some hockey left in Brian Trottier. And I felt if I went to Pittsburgh and was just myself and didn't change myself or try to fit in as a role player, I just wanted to be myself, that good things were going to happen. I thought the talent level in Pittsburgh was really good. And talking to Craig and Bob Johnson, there was a feeling of want there that made me feel pretty good about myself.
I think what he brought to the team is naturally the winning tradition from the Islanders. I guess the ability to keep the players not as much relaxed as focused on what they have to do. He's a big team guy.
In most sports, just winning one championship would be enough to have a team considered great. But in the NHL, it takes more than that. Over the last 18 years, only six different teams have won the Stanley Cup. And so now, as the Pittsburgh Penguins stand on the verge of their second straight NHL championship, talk of another hockey dynasty is already beginning. That's it from Chicago, Vic. Let's go back to you at Sports Desk.
Cord, thanks very much. Some other things to consider heading into this game four. Pittsburgh are trying to win their 11th straight game in this year's playoffs. The Penguins would be the first team since the Islanders in 82 to sweep both a semifinal and a final in the same year. And a Pittsburgh win would make it eight straight winning series. Also, the Penguins have some history on their side. No Pittsburgh team has ever lost a championship final since the Pirates of 1927. That includes four Super Bowls for the Steelers, three Pirates World Series, one ABA championship, and even a title in World Team Tennis. As for Chicago, well, they also have some history to look back on, and it looks awful. The Hawks are 0-14 in a playoff series when they lose the first three. And there is no doubt that scoring the first goal goes a long way to winning.
Chicago 7-1 in the playoffs when they score first.
Today on Sports Desk, the Pittsburgh Penguins stand alone as NHL champions once again. The Ryan Express blows out a wheel and is derailed again. And Lions quarterback Danny Barrett tees it up in Vancouver.
Sports Desk brought to you by Chevrolet. Times change, values don't.
Everyone, and welcome to Sports Desk. Also ahead on the show, Dennis Martinez mows them down in Houston. We've got highlights from the French Open and news from the CFL. But first to the Stanley Cup Final, and the Pittsburgh Penguins have done it again. They had the Chicago Blackhawks on the ropes Monday night. Only the 1942 Toronto Maple Leafs had ever rebounded from a 3-0 deficit to win four straight and take home the cup. But in the end, the Penguins would prove to be just too much for the Blackhawks. This was a tremendously entertaining game. Blackhawk fans not giving up. Early in the first, Pittsburgh that opens the scoring. Jaromir Jagr's quick shot finds the corner, and the Penguins are up 1-0. Later on, the Hawks finally score on home ice. Dirk Graham gets his own rebound and ties the game up at 1. Then just 12 seconds later, it is Lemieux to Kevin Stephens, and his weak shot slides through Belfour. That made it 2-1 for Pittsburgh. Over at the Hawks bench, Keenan was furious. He says, get ready, Hasek, you're going in. So he did. Just 18 seconds after that, Chris Chelios over to Dirk Graham. A great pass. Bourassa, no chance on it. Tied the game up at 2. But then Chelios follows it up with a stupid play. Still angry at Larry Murphy. Runs him. Ends up getting an elbowing penalty, and it costs the Hawks. Mario Lemieux, he takes the pass, then he lets it rip. His 16th of the playoffs put Pittsburgh up 3-2. But Chicago does not quit. Brian Noonan in the corner finds Dirk Graham, his third of the night for the Chicago captain. And the Hats, they came right out of the balcony, littering the ice at Chicago Stadium. The game was tied at 3 after 20 minutes. On to the second period, and Pittsburgh starts fast. Rick Tocchet, who's having a great final, scores his 6th of the spring. Lemieux and Stevens with assists on the goal. Pens are up 4-3. Later on, Lemieux again, some incredible moves. He sets up Stevens. Yes, that pass goes through his legs, but he fires it wide. That was tough. Later on in the second, Jeremy Roenick finally gets on the board, and his shot bounces in off of Larry Murphy. It was 4-4 after 40 minutes. But the fans remain behind their Hawks. The noise and cheering did not let up. Third period now, still 4-4. Mario Lemieux on the breakaway, but an outstanding glove save, and this robs Super Mario. Then just moments later, Rick Tocchet from behind the net finds Larry Murphy at the point. His shot beats Hasek. It was 5-4 Pens. Now with 12:01 left in the game, Chris Chelios caught in the pinch. Ron Francis on the 2-on-1. His blast beats Hasek, and it was 6-4 Pens. And it looked like Lord Stanley's mug would be returning to Steel Town as it waited in the wings. Less than a minute to go in the game. Pens up 6-5, Chicago pressing, but they cannot get the equalizer. The clock runs out, and the Pittsburgh Penguins win their second straight Stanley Cup. Boy, have I got goal scorers to tell you. Jaromir Jagr, Kevin Stephens, Mario Lemieux, Rick Tocchet, Larry Murphy, and Ron Francis for Pittsburgh. For Chicago, Dirk Graham with 3 goals, Jeremy Roenick with 2. Some interesting facts. Scotty Bowman becomes only the third coach to win Stanley Cups with 2 different teams. The Penguins have won 11 straight in the postseason, tying the Hawks record that set earlier this season. And Pittsburgh becomes the first team to sweep the semifinal and the final since the Islanders did it back in 1982. Now, the Conn Smythe trophy winner, was there really any question? No way. Mario the Magnificent. He is only the second player in playoff history to win back-to-back Conn Smythe trophies. Bernie Parent of the Flyers won it back in 74 and 75. So Lemieux joins Parent, Bobby Orr, and Wayne Gretzky as the only multiple winners of the Conn Smythe trophy. Now with more, standing by in Chicago, here's our Gord Miller.
They saved the best for last, did the Penguins and the Blackhawks. Game four of this series featured the kind of high-powered, end-to-end offensive hockey we've been expecting at the start. What few could have expected was a Pittsburgh sweep, but in the end, it was too much experience, too much good goaltending, and too much Mario Lemieux for the Blackhawks to handle.
I didn't expect to win the Smythe. You know, I thought it was Tommy all the way. You know, I missed six games, and Tommy was superb the last three games against Washington, against the Rangers. He was unbelievable, and against Boston, and again in this series. So, you know, this should have gone to Tommy, that's for sure.
You know, that's 11 games in a row for this team against real top teams, Rangers, Boston, and Chicago, you know, and we just got on a roll. We're down against Washington and came back, and, you know, to win so many games against so many good teams, we had a lot of breaks, we had good goaltending, and we had great leadership from Mario Lemieux.
We've done it, so we can say we're champions. We can blow our own horn for a couple months.
These guys made me know what it feels to be with winners, and I can't say enough for each guy on this team.
You did
your part. Guys like Brian and everybody else, I like I said, I just can't say enough.
To win one, sometimes you can be a little bit lucky, but to win them back-to-back, I think, is quite an accomplishment.
I was proud of our team and proud of our players. I thank them from the bottom of my heart for their contribution in making us a very successful organization this year, for coming together as a team that went through extreme number of changes. I'm extremely proud of their efforts and their contributions, both as individuals and as a team.
Okay. Guarantee you one thing, I'm going to bust my ass every single game that I play in this National Hockey League to get back here again and win one of these things, because I got a taste for it this year, and that taste is never going to go away, and I'm determined to win this thing one of these years. It'll happen.
Well, I'm just going to go in the room and try to dive in the cup now.
Much like the National Hockey League itself, the Pittsburgh Penguins endured a turbulent season, but in the end, talent prevailed, and already the questions have begun. Can this Pittsburgh team establish itself as one of the truly dominant National Hockey League teams? That question has yet to be answered. But clearly for now, Mario Lemieux and company have no rivals in the National Hockey League. Reporting from the 1992 Stanley Cup Championship, Gord Miller, TSN, Chicago.
So the Pittsburgh Penguins win their second straight Stanley Cup. And you know, I hope that if the Penguins are honored at the White House again this year, I really hope that President George Bush and remember who Mario Lemieux is, because last year he forgot who Mario Lemieux was, and after all they've been through this year, old George owes them.
Today, another Stanley Cup might finally mean some respect for Pittsburgh. Monica Seles leads the ladies at the French Open. And what the Blackhawks really needed was Glenn Hall.
Sports Desk is brought to you by Motomaster, Canada's number one selling replacement parts.
Hello again, everybody. Welcome to this edition of Sports Desk. Also, during the next half hour for you, Danny Barrett working very hard trying to sell Lions tickets in Vancouver, and it will be Air Jordan against Clyde the Glide, an NBA final preview. But first, for about 10 minutes of the first period last night, it really was the kind of series that everybody expected. Problem is, we didn't see enough of it, and now we won't see any more. There were no miracles at the Madison Madhouse as the Pittsburgh Penguins once again overpowered Chicago to sweep their way to a second straight Stanley Cup.
The Penguins arrived home around 4 in the morning, Wendell Young leading the team off the plane with the Stanley Cup. Only a small crowd on hand at Pittsburgh Airport after police urged people to stay away, avoid the problems that 20,000 caused a year ago. The official Civic Victory Party will be held Thursday at Three River Stadium. 4 hours earlier at Chicago Stadium, it was a 4-4 tie as they started the third period, and Dominic Hasek stops Mario Lemieux on the breakaway. However, Hasek couldn't stop Larry Murphy, who scores from the point to give Pittsburgh a 5-4 lead. Then with 8 minutes gone in the third, Chris Chelios is caught. The Penguins away, a 2-on-1, and Ron Francis beats Hasek, and it was 6-4 Penguins, and it really did look like the Stanley Cup was Pittsburgh's again. Jeremy Roenick scored to make it 6-5. The Hawks pressed for the tying goal final minute, but time in the game, the series, and the season ran out on Chicago. Mario Lemieux and Pittsburgh win their second straight Stanley Cup, and they do it in a sweep over Chicago in the NHL's 75th season.
You know, after last year's Stanley Cup win, you could almost hear most people say, sure, but let's see them do it again. Well, they have. The Pittsburgh Penguins have overcome the death of their coach, then the adjustment to Scotty Bowman, and some mediocre play during the regular season to prove they may indeed be the next NHL dynasty team. Yeah, it's time to admit it, folks. This is a very good team.
There has never been a more dominating team than the Montreal Canadiens of the late 50s. Toe Blake coached Montreal to 5 consecutive Stanley Cups, a record which still stands. Then in the early 80s, the New York Islanders had a stranglehold on the rest of the NHL. They won 4 straight cups before relinquishing the title to a young team with some of the most talented players the game has ever seen. The Edmonton Oilers collected 4 championships in 5 years. And that brings us to the Penguins. Yes, Pittsburgh. Could this really be the next team on the verge of a dynasty? Oh man, wait a minute, back it up, rewind. Dynasty, I mean, dynasty is a word often spoken too quickly and used too freely, but not about the Penguins. The Penguins have a wealth of it. The average age of the team, 28.8 years of age, which certainly indicates the veterans have a great influence in Pittsburgh. Scotty Bowman engineered his 6th Stanley Cup as a coach, and Brian Trottier also won his 6th, which just goes to show that winners breed winning.
It's like sitting at Liberty Tunnel and you don't see that light at the other tunnel. But when I first got here, I saw that light and I just knew that coming here, these guys made me know what it feels to be with winners. And I can't say enough for each guy on this team.
With the loss of 42-goal scorer Joey Mullen, certain Penguins picked up their game a notch with crucial goals at critical times. Consider this. In 49 playoff games, Lemieux has 97 points and has won 2 straight Conn Smythe trophies.
When you talk about dynasty, who knows? We'll know next year, I guess, at this time. But, you know, I like our chances for the next few years.
Many of the least known Penguins are the defensemen. With the additions of the Samuelsons, the Penguins now have a solid defensive core. Love him or hate him, Ulf Samuelsson is as steady as they come.
Ezek, Mario, still very young. Kevin, a lot of our nucleus is young, and we feel we're capable of doing this again.
As many coaches will tell you, you only go as far as your goaltending. And Tom Barrasso finished with a 2.40 goals against average in this year's playoffs. According to Lemieux, Barrasso was the real Conn Smythe winner. A large degree of the Penguins' success has to also go to general manager Craig Patrick. The acquisition of several players through trades strengthened Pittsburgh to make them an even better team than their first that won a championship a year ago. All this means, of course, another trip to Pennsylvania Avenue, the White House. And you can bet this year's conversation will be just a little bit different.
And you are?
Mario Lemieux.
Mario, I was talking about you. I had that feeling.
One other thing about those Penguins, Pittsburgh was 39, 32, and 9 during the regular season. However, in the playoffs, they were 16 and 5. All right, so what happened to Chicago? Hard to believe they went into the final winning 11 straight games. The problem is, the style that beat teams such as St. Louis, Detroit, and Edmonton just didn't work against the faster Penguins. And what about Hawks coach Mike Keenan, who for the third time takes a team to the final, only to lose? Here's Gord Miller.
Despite the rousing ovation from their fans, despite the accomplishments of the regular season and the playoffs, for many of the Blackhawks, it was too much to take. Jeremy Roenick couldn't bear to watch the cup being presented to the Penguins.
I don't know if I'll ever get back here again or how many times I'll get back here again. I'll guarantee you one thing, I'm going to bust my ass every single game that I play in this National Hockey League to get back here again and win one of these things. Because I got a taste for it this year. And that taste is never going to go away.
The toughest thing is that we just never quite
got it what we wanted to achieve, and that's hard to, you know, it's hard to accept. We worked hard to get where we're at, and it's a hard thing to deal with. Thing about it, I guess it's a hell of an experience for all of us.
This team never quit. I mean, through thick and thin, all season long. I think we learned a lot all year, and what we learned got us to where we were. It was just a matter of taking that next step, and we didn't.
Not surprisingly, the most emotion came from Mike Keenan, who paid tribute to his mentor, Scott Bowman, in an emotional scene on the ice, and then paid tribute to a team that oftentimes seemed to resent his tight control.
We're coming together as a team that went through extreme number of changes. I'm extremely proud of their efforts and their contributions, both as individuals and as a team.
Over the past 12 months, Chicago head coach Mike Keenan made more than a dozen trades. For now, he says he's happy with his club and doesn't plan any more moves. But assistant coach Daryl Sutter wants a chance to coach an NHL team. And with Keenan under intense criticism for the way he handled his club during the finals, the biggest question mark on the Chicago roster is the one that appears next to the name of the head coach. Gord Miller, TSN, Chicago.
Still with the NHL, empty seats, poor ratings during the playoffs. Advertisers say viewership in the Toronto area, which is the largest market in the country, was off 25%. In fact, some games between Montreal and Hartford drew less than a million viewers. And what about those empty seats in cities such as Edmonton? Unheard of. I mean, you couldn't sell out a playoff game against Vancouver.
Today on Sports Desk, Monica Seles and Gabriella Sabatini put on a show in the French Open semifinals. The Pittsburgh Penguins' cup runneth over as Trottier and 35 others celebrate. And the draw for post positions at the Belmont Stakes.
Is brought to you by Motomaster, Canada's number one selling replacement parts.
Welcome to the show, everybody. I'm Michael Landsberg. Also ahead over the next half hour, World Bowl festivities begin in Montreal. We'll preview Spruce Meadows this coming weekend, and as well, we'll look at Sean Burke, the catcher. But we begin with the French Open semifinals. One turned out to be a dazzling display of shot-making and power tennis. Number one seed Monica Seles taking on number three Gabriella Sabatini. Those two have had some great matches in the past, but none greater than today's. Seles had won the past two French Opens, and early on in this one, it looked like she would cruise to a spot in the final. Well, we all had to look again because this one changed midway. There's Monica Seles looking for her third straight title against Gabriella Sabatini. This is her fifth French Open semifinal berth. She's never won one. First set's tied at three. Seles rips the forehand winner to take a 4-3 lead. Now watch this great point. Sabatini with a beautiful volley at the net. Right there anticipating, but there is Seles to run it down, and she scores the forehand winner, taking the first set 6-3. But second set, Sabatini battles back. And watch this forehand passing shot right there down the line. It just caught the tape, and you see her reaction. That's as excited as she gets. 6-4, Sabatini won the second set. Third set, we're tied at four. Here's the key point of the match. Just wide. Seles scores the break to go up 5-4. And Seles can smell victory. Watch Monica Seles just rip a forehand, freezing Sabatini. She swings and misses. And we go to match point now. Gabriella Sabatini with the bad mishit of the serve, bad way to end it, but it turned out to be a terrific match. 6-3, 4-6, and 6-4, Monica Seles advances to the final. She will look for her third straight French Open championship on Saturday. And Seles says, yes, this one could have gone either way.
Told myself to hang in there. I had so many chances in the second set, and that four, I had like 2 or 3 40 left, and very impressive to change the match. And I just said, you know, you blew her again, the same thing like in Rome, you know, you were leading and she came back, and just go for it. And some shots just really went in, which I couldn't kind of believe. And then, you know, it was very close. It could have gone either way again, I think.
But it went to Seles. There are four top players in women's tennis. And after the big four, there is a big fallout. All four were in the semis. The other saw number two, Steffi Graf, taking on number four, Arantxa Sanchez Vicario. And remember last year, Sanchez Vicario completely destroyed Steffi Graf in the French Open semis, beating her 6-love and 6-2. And Graf must have had to give her head a shake, because this match started as if she still hadn't woken up from the nightmare last year. First set action.
Well played,
there's Sanchez Vicario. Graf does not win a single game in the first set. It went, just like last year, 6-love. Right, Sanchez Vicario on her game, Graf was not. But the second set, a different story. Steffi Graf starts to take control. Watch the forehand by Steffi Graf. Boom! She loads it up and passes. Graf leads the second set 4-1. Steffi Graf also had some luck on her side in the second set that she didn't have in the first. Here she hits the tape and scores the point. She wins the second set 6-2. After losing the first two games of the final set, Graf regroups once again. This one went back and forth. Perfect. Top spin lob. There's nothing you can do. Then Graf comes in behind her serve and rips a cannon forehand. She wins her fifth straight game. She leads it 5-2. We go to match point now. Sanchez Vicario's backhand is just long by that much. And Steffi Graf can give a big smile and a big sigh of relief. This one ends up, check out the scores, love 6, 6-2, and 6-2. And considering last year, Steffi Graf had to be really pleased that she was able to come back over those final two sets.
I think what I showed in the last two sets was pretty strong performance, and I just feel good about being in the Saturday final, and I hope to be ready for it.
Looks like it should be a great final. There was a berth in the men's semifinals left today because of darkness yesterday. Peter Korda, the seventh seed from Czechoslovakia, faced unseeded Russian Andrei Cherkasov, and we'll pick it up at match point. It'll be Peter Korda in the far set, just completing his serve. And Korda wins it with a forehand and wins his quarterfinal match. Again, this is men's quarterfinal play, advancing to a place he's never been before, the semifinals of the French Open. Number seven seed Peter Korda, 6-4, 6-7, 6-2, 6-4 victory in the quarterfinals. So Korda advances to the next round. So the men's semifinals look like this. Jim Courier will take on Andre Agassi. Courier, the defending champion. Agassi simply devastating against Sampras. That will be live on TSN at 1 o'clock Eastern time tomorrow. And the other men's semifinal looks like this. Peter Korda against hometown favorite Henri Leconte. And if you saw the French fans in the Davis Cup, you know they will be wildly supportive. Tough place for Korda to be. The mixed doubles team of Jill Hetherington and Glenn Michibata were bounced from the French Open today. In the quarterfinals, they lost to Lori McNeil and Brian Shelton, both from the United States. Great tennis today, but lots more to come in this edition of Sports Desk. When we return, Michael Jordan. Those two words sum up last night's tip-off of the NBA final. Jordan was just unstoppable in the first half, and that set the tone for the Bulls' blowout of the Portland Trail Blazers. And Pittsburgh, for the second straight year, gets to whoop it up over the Penguins. We'll show you the whoop it up ceremonies right after this.
Get ready for the hottest new cards in the world. Sizzling new for 92. Donruss, a radical redesign. With action so big, facts so bold, rookie and elite cards so great, they're almost too hot to handle. The sizzling new 92 Donruss cards. They're turning the collecting world upside down.
Nice catch. Nice come up, Mike.
No one packs excitement like Donruss.
The problem's obvious. You need a new muffler. Well, right now at Canadian Tire, we'll install any MotoMaster muffler for both imported and domestic cars for just $34.95. And they're guaranteed for as long as you own your car. Now that's one deal that looks as good as it sounds. MotoMaster, Canada's number one selling replacement parts.
They say in sport that it's so tough to repeat because to win a championship, so many things have to fall in place. The Pittsburgh Penguins have proved that wrong. Not because they repeated, but because they did it through all kinds of injury and all kinds of trauma and adversity. They simply found a way to win. So for the second straight year, the city of Pittsburgh was able to whoop it up and say, we're number one.
We will begin the parade of everybody involved in the Penguins organization, so I will tell you, get in the fast lane, Grandma. The bingo game is ready to roll.
35,000 screaming Penguin fans didn't let a little rain stop them from cheering on the Stanley Cup champions. Three River Stadium was rocking.
Certainly like to thank all the fans for supporting us again this year and believing in this team, even though we struggled for the early part of the playoffs, but came back strong against Washington, and the guys showed a lot of character against the Rangers, and we never quit. We showed a lot of character, and you guys were a big part of it, so on behalf of the team, we love you guys, and hopefully we'll be here next year.
How about those reporters who said it couldn't be done? Let's do away with them. Anyone got a gun?